Chair Pollack is coming up now, and she's going to probably give us a good explanation here.
Well, we've got a guy running for president who says the system's rigged, but I don't think he's right about much. So, you know, hey, there were other good contestants. That's all I can say. And what I'd like to do now is point out that Gord has done a fabulous job of introducing this. I don't think there's anything else to add except to stress that I'm holding up, for those of you who are close enough to see, a long list, 36 people who have asked to speak. Multiply that by 3 minutes, and we're going to be here a while. So do not even think of going 3.2 minutes. You're all important. It's not that you're not important, but that you're not so important that you should stand in the way of the other people who have also signed up to speak. So please, let's be respectful. You've got paddles here. You've got a yellow paddle that says you've got what left, Chuck? 30 seconds left. It's going to go fast. My son, who's a speechwriter, tells me, "Mom, it's 120 words per minute. If you have more than that in your minute, people aren't going to understand you. If you have more than three times that in your 3 minutes, you're going to go into somebody else's time." So that's it. We will listen, and we will listen carefully, and we will hear you. And what you say is super important. So all the admonitions of don't take long does not mean that we don't consider this important. Thank you.
Thank you, Lana. And one point, we're going to use only the one microphone that's located here in the center, and that'll be best for acoustics for everyone. And again, the 3-minute rule is going to be enforced by these very strong enforcers on here. When you see a yellow paddle, I hope you're not colorblind, yellow paddle, that will indicate you've got about, what, 30 seconds to go. And then when you see the red paddle, that's about 5 seconds before that lady is going to go and hit you over the head. So, we have to recognize this. Now listen, there may be some things that require longer than 3 minutes, in which case, speak to us afterwards and we'll set up an arrangement where we can hear that. If there are things that just can't be got out in that short period of time, look, we'll make a special arrangement. If we have to come back tomorrow morning at 6:30 in the morning to hear you, we'll make a special arrangement with you. So don't worry if you've really got something. So do kind of hold to that. I think that, in fairness, we've got to stay with that if we're going to get through this list. I don't think any of us anticipated a list that would come this long. So it's rather shocking. It's rather good that we're hearing this much. So that's all good news. So let's. I think we've probably covered off everything here. Now, the way we do this, we've got to keep with the baseball analogy. So, you know, there's a person at bat. That person will be at the microphone. The person who, of course, is waiting to get at bat on deck will be just behind. And then just behind that person will be the person so-called in the hole.
Because the Blue Jays won yesterday.
Absolutely. That's why we've got to stick with this. It could have been hockey, but, you know, we've got a problem in
that
question.
So it's Catherine Masson.
Yep.
Grand Chief Abram Benedict, please, and then Dave Ulrich in that order. So if you could
So those are the first
approach
three.
The thing, and we look forward to your comments. Followed by John Jackson, Barry Johnson, Jacqueline Wilson. So I've given you the first seven. Catherine, please go ahead.
Now, before we start, though, some of you may have questions and have not registered online or observations to make. So please make your observations known to someone on a card. I think if you bring them to this table right here, then they can be brought forward to us at the right moment. So we're not totally restricted, but that they might be towards the end of the afternoon. So, Catherine.
Good afternoon. In its oversight position, the IJC is tasked to take the short view on the water quality agreement, which we could argue is the report we've just looked at now, the midterm view, and also the long view. Also, the IJC, in its International Watersheds Initiative, has committed as one of the five commitments to help develop in watersheds a shared vision. And that, I think, is being undertaken in three of the boundary water watersheds at this time. However, we do not have an active, widely shared vision for the Great Lakes. There is certainly one in the Water Quality Agreement that has to do with the two parties. Many organizations working on behalf of the Great Lakes have their own vision statement, but we do not have for the Great Lakes, and shall we say also the Great, the St. Lawrence River, a shared vision. That is not the case in many other large watersheds that are transboundary watersheds around the world. And I would urge the Commission to consider initiating a process whereby citizens participate in a widely shared vision. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Catherine.
Thank you, Catherine.
Grand Chief.
So, Grand Chief Abram Benedict.
Yes, sir. Number 30 said I could have his 3 minutes. I just wanted to let you know that. So.
All right.
Just kidding. Sago, greetings. I am Grand Chief Abram Benedict from the community of Akwesasne. I'm representing today the Chiefs of Ontario Secretariat. I'm the Environment Portfolio Holder. So, Honorable Commissioners, IJC, delegates, elders, respected treaty people of Turtle Island, we bring greetings from the Political Confederacy of the Chiefs of Ontario Secretariat on this occasion. The gathering of party delegates for the 2012 Great Lakes Quality Agreement. As custom amongst our respective First Nations, this day began with prayer, thanksgiving of the natural world, the world. Words that come before all else, Hondo Galiadekwa. We welcome you to the dish with one spoon, homelands of the Anishinaabek and the Haudenosaunee, who have shared their Great Lakes Basin territory and beaver hunting grounds with many nations and people. First Nations people have lived in peace and harmony with the Great Lakes Basin since time immemorial. It is our inherent respect for the natural world, sustained uses of the natural resources, traditional knowledge of the areas we live in our commitment to the future health of the Great Lakes for all people who it brings to this discussion. Our message is simple today. It is time for the IJC to recognize the jurisdiction inherent in treaty right of First Nations in all governance matters affecting the homeland of many First Nations across the Great Lakes. Due consideration for options consistent with the finding of the Truth and Reconciliation Report and calls for a new respectful relationship between Canada are options that respect First Nations jurisdiction. It is also consistent with the United Declarations on the Rights of Indigenous People and affirms the principle of equality while affirming that all people can contribute to the diverse and richness in protecting the Great Lakes environment for all of our future. In making this request, we acknowledge the steps of the IJC have already taken, in particular, the appointment of Dr. Henry Lickers, who I must mention is from my community, to the Science Advisory Board, and Mr. Dean Jacobs to the Water Quality Board. We acknowledge these steps. These are the steps in the right direction. We have many others who have made unwavering commitments to the health of the Great Lakes Basin. We express our deepest expression to the gratitudes of Grandmother Josephine Mandaman, who we'll hear from tomorrow, our Women Water Commissioners, and all those who support the efforts of the Great Lakes St. Lawrence Water Walkers. We acknowledge our First Nations ambassadors, our youth, our women, our elders, our faith keepers, and our political leaders. Our technicians tell us that First Nation opportunities are meaningful, particularly in development of reports for the annexes to the Great Lakes Water Agreement. Those participations are far and few in between. Engagement with First Nations people in the development of reports on the health of the Great Lakes environment should be paramount to the work that is being done. Consultation by the Crown is important fiduciary responsibility, and we need to work together to achieve that. We understand that the Environment and Climate Change Canada has invited Chiefs of Ontario to appoint one technician to the Annex 9 subcommittee. We applaud this decision, but we encourage more subcommittee participation by our people. In order for meaningful engagement to occur with First Nations, resources need to be provided to participate to be fair and equitable. We call upon Environment Canada to support First Nations capacity and collaboration in implementing the 10 annexes of the agreement. From the sleeping giants of Manitouan Island to the bays of Quinte and the Gulf of the St. Lawrence, and all points in between, our creation stories, our songs, our ceremonies, our traditions, and the voice of our ancestors echo, ripple across the waters. Our oral histories are etched in across the shorelines and landscapes. We will continue to assert the need for respect, equity, empowerment through the voices of our ancestors. In conclusion, of our elders, the conviction of our women as water keepers, the hopes and dreams of young ambassadors and young men and women for the future that faces us ahead. We thank the IGC for the opportunity to share these words and welcome the opportunity to move forward. Yaungo.
Chief, thank you very much. We're deeply indebted always to the contributions made by the First Nations, by the Métis, by the tribes. So it is a huge contribution. Thank you.
I add my thanks. And I also just want to tell everybody here, because I know we've put the pressure on for time, you can communicate online, www.participateijc.org. That would go, of course, to people who are not in this room as well as in this room. And we will indeed be reading and listening to all submissions. Thank you again for that very positive and helpful submission.
We need a non-deck person.
You have this little, you have this that tells you how to participate.
You'll find the website on here. This is what.
Yep.
So look on your table. But we need our on-deck person, so Mark.
No.
I'm here.
Dave, all right.
No, I know. Well, you're not on deck. You're at bat.
Oh, sorry. Oh.
Dave Ulrich's at bat. Mark's coming up and soon to be followed by John Jackson, wherever. What is your name? That is an important thing. Could you please, in all cases, state the name and your organization? And if you'd like to tell us where you came from, that's very helpful, too. But not sure who you are. We know Dave Ulrich.
My name is David Ulrich, and as suggested in the video, I am a voice of the Great Lakes community. And as suggested by you, Commissioner, we're all in this together, and I don't intend this to be a finger-pointing exercise. But, number one, if we never knew it before, we know it today that we are not doing the job we need to do in terms of engagement of Indigenous peoples. The Water Quality Board, among others, is going to be dedicating an entire meeting to better understanding how we can improve. We will come back to the Commission with recommendations from that and hope to provide some good suggestions that can be passed on to the parties and the rest of the community. I would be remiss if I did not point out that also at the Great Lakes Restoration Conference in Sandusky, minority low-income communities around the Great Lakes do not feel that they are being engaged effectively. So we as a community need to do a better job on this. Number two, climate change. Mike Ripley mentioned a couple of things already. This is huge. It is going to make all of the challenges we have even greater. Federal governments, Canada right now, the U.S. Recently, are stepping forward on the mitigation side as well as adaptation. There is pushback, but under the Water Quality Agreement and otherwise, we need to deal with this. Cities, who I work with, are stepping forward under the Global Covenant of Mayors to seek better adaptation and mitigation, and we will continue to do that. Nutrients, also a reference earlier to work of the Great Lakes Water Quality Board, making suggestions to the parties and to the states and provinces as to some specific things that could be done. As a follow-up to my question, I think for the domestic action plans, we need to be much more specific in terms of where the reductions have to be achieved, how much the reductions have to be, and time frames for achieving them. I don't know if it can necessarily go down to farm by farm or source by source, but it's got to be more specific than it has been in the past. I take my hats off to the parties for making a major step forward on utilization of indicators in this report of the parties of progress. Tremendous progress has been made in presenting this information. I think there is more work that needs to be done in terms of being able to understand what's happening. You know, the bottom line is that the Great Lakes are good and unchanging, and we do have a bottom line, but I think there are ways we can flesh that out a little bit more. Very specifically on chemicals of concern, PBDEs and radionuclides, parties take the ball and run. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. Mark.
Evening, Commissioner.
Mark is the president of the Lake Ontario Waterkeepers, as we heard earlier, and I've lost my sticker.
Yes. Thank you very much, and I'll be very quick. I just want to start by saying I'm a waterkeeper for Lake Ontario, but I've also been a member of the Great Lakes Water Quality Board now for two terms, and I'm honored to be on the Great Lakes Water Quality Board and to work on public engagement and consultation. And I think it's been interesting and successful, and I think the board and everyone involved has been moving and recognizing the need to be more consultative and also to be more engaging. Just two things moving forward. One, it's funny, I think we're all changing, particularly here in Canada recently, but even watching the video, I think we do need to address the issue of two nations on the Great Lakes. That's no longer true. And I think we do need to acknowledge our First Nations and their role over the sovereignty and the and making the Great Lakes swimmable, drinkable, fishable. So I think that's something we should move up to the forefront to address, and whether we have to look at the constitutional obligations of the Canadian government to consult, which is in the relationship with the U.S., I think it's time for the IJC to recognize that and be the first to truly put it forward. And secondly, I think in terms of consultation, I love the video when it talks about it's your voice, and we are getting people's voices. However, I feel they're not seeing their face in some of the material that comes back from the IJC. We still talk in aggregate. We put things together and come up with trend lines, and things are getting better or worse, or they're unchanging. Mm-hmm. People want to see their issues dealt with. Their voice and their concerns, if they can't swim in the water or touch it or eat it or drink it, they're here to tell you that, and they want that to be addressed somehow. I know there isn't a clear answer to that. It's difficult, and I know we're trying. Doing polling, more consultation. But the IJC has to recognize that's the most important thing for the people of the Great Lakes when they come to you and express their concerns and they can't drink the water, or they can't eat the fish, or they can't go swimming. And we have to do a better job of reflecting that and letting them know they're heard. And as the Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement says, engaging them and empowering them to go and act individually. So I'd like to put that out there, and thank you very much for being here today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments earlier today. Very inspiring.
It's very useful that we have members of our boards here hearing this information as well. So you're talking not just the IJC, you're talking to many more people that are very important in the process. John Jackson should be coming up, and Barry Johnson should be next, and Jacqueline Wilson. So.
Okay, John Jackson, and I'm speaking in terms of someone who for about 35 years has been participant in Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement processes, and to make up some observations in terms of the public engagement aspect of it. And I'm talking particularly to the governments, but I know the IJC too is part of this. And we're excited about the number of people here today, and this is great. However, we have a lot further to go in terms of public involvement in these meetings. This is overwhelmingly government people. It's overwhelmingly, the people at universities and scientists and so on. But the real on-the-ground citizen activists, we need to have them much more engaged in our water quality agreement processes. There's a lot more excitement and dynamism that we can bring to our meetings. I've learned an incredible amount. But I do remember meetings where, in Duluth, for example, 1,900 people came out to the IJC's biennial meeting at that time. The meeting before that in Windsor, 2,000 people came out. So yes, 700 is great, but let's not be satisfied with that. Let's push for more in terms of the dynamism and excitement of that. And I'm not sure this is something I should tell you, but I remember the Hamilton meetings where we had presentations from the public, which went on until midnight, and the commission I did feel sorry for sitting there through all that, but it showed the excitement and the engagement from the citizens on the ground, people coming out to be engaged in these processes. And I really feel that unless we get not just all those great community groups that are out there on the ground doing the work, which is so essential, is wonderful, we're going to hear a lot of that tomorrow, but we need them also engaged in our processes to be bringing, first of all, the energy and the dynamism of saying why we have to do better. I mean, you know, the evaluation, that's actually pretty pitiful that we heard yesterday morning. It was a great, and I appreciate its directness and clarity, but boy, we should be upset and angry about that. And if we're not having the people at our meetings who are experiencing that to bring that energy and dynamism to the governments and say, this just isn't good enough. Keep going at it. We appreciate what you're doing, but bring us more. The other thing is, a big step forward is public engagement in the water quality agreement, and that was really stressed. That hasn't been happening far enough. I think the Annex 2, for example, is making valiant efforts, but it's taking forever. People can't sit around for 3 years waiting to figure out what the process is for them to be engaged. And we also need to immediately communicate with the people who said they want to be engaged to keep them up to date on what's happening. So just more to be done, a lot more to be done, and you know, get that excitement and dynamism back into our work is absolutely critical.
Thank you. Barry. Barry Johnson, Greening of Detroit.
From Troy, Michigan, not Troy. Detroit, Troy, Michigan.
Well.
Okay. This forum is focused on assessment of the state of the Great Lakes. Actions being taken were also discussed. I'm a volunteer with the Greening of Detroit, a nonprofit 501c3. Since 1989, we've planted 88,000 trees with funding from the EPA, GLRI, the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative, and friends from the Detroit Water and Sewers Department. We have planted trees in the Rouge River watershed, a tributary that enters the Detroit River. We've received funds from the EPA for a dendroremediation project that will produce best practice documents for removing pollutants from soils. In 2000, emerald ash borer, an invasive insect species, was discovered in Wayne County, Michigan. Emerald ash borer has devastated forests in Michigan, Illinois, Ohio, Ontario. It is now in 27 states and 2 provinces. So that's, what, 16 years, right? Forest degradation is real. Air quality suffers, runoff and erosion increase. The IJC must consider forest losses in their planning. The EPA and Canada's equivalent must continue to fund green infrastructure. Forests are the Earth's lungs. That was fast and sweet to the point, probably less than
that. Ah, very good. Well,
and clear.
That gives me a moment to call before Jacqueline to indicate that Mr. Zhang is coming up here, and then Gerald Parker. So, Jacqueline.
Thanks very much. I'm Jacqueline Wilson. I'm a lawyer with the Canadian Environmental Law Association. We're also a member of the Extended Subcommittee on Chemicals of Mutual Concern, so I'm going to focus my comments on Annex 3 today. The first issue we want to raise is that the current tracking of pollution levels in the Great Lakes is insufficient. In looking at the data before coming today, in 2012 in Ontario alone, there was over 1.5 million kilograms of carcinogens released to air, and that's only in Ontario. It gives you a sense of the scope of some of the issues, but it also highlights that as a member of an ENGO, the data that's available through NPRI and the CEC is quite out of date. It's 2012 or 2013. So our recommendation is that annual reporting of pollutant releases and transfers to the Great Lakes Basin should be created so that there's annual reporting and it provides us with an accurate base of data that we can all work with. In looking at that data, though, the trend is going in the wrong direction. In For on and off-site releases of pollutants for the Great Lakes watershed, it increased by 35.15%. It's quite a lot between 2009 and 2013. And for persistent bioaccumulative substances, the increase was 12.37% from 2009 to 2013. The current pace of work under Annex 3 is not reflective of that, the urgency of the issue. It's taken 3 years for the parties to confirm the first short set of chemicals of mutual concern, and there's no action plans in place yet. And there's no clear timeline in the 2014 Canada-Ontario Agreement to identify and address chemicals of concern into the future. The second issue we wanted to raise is about public engagement under Annex 3. We're at a critical juncture right now in implementation of the annex, and work on the binational strategies is underway. And CELA, along with 110 environmental, health, and other advocacy groups, urged the parties in March 2016 to jointly designate radionuclides, which we'd obviously encourage the governments to do, as a chemical of mutual concern under Annex 3. But what we need now is clarity on the next steps of that nomination process, public engagement in that process. And of course, we want to stress the need for that focus on public participation to reflect the commitments made by the parties in the Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement. And the last point we wanted to make today is that CELA, in a 2015 report, looked at the challenge of non-point source and product-based substances within the Annex 3 context. And we drew on EU's REACH framework. So we'd like to see the action plans that are created focus on prevention, on adoption of new approaches, like informed substitution and safer alternatives. Thanks very much.
Jacqueline, that looks like a copious submission. Can you file that with us if
absolutely.
At some point?
Yes, that would definitely. Be good. Thanks.
Thank you. Next, we have T.O. Hang. I believe I've got the right pronunciation. And I don't know if that person's in the room, but we'll put that in the parking lot and move to Gerald Parker and then Jill Taylor and then Ellen Daly. So.
It was TQ. Shang?
No.
He's not here. Okay.
My name's Gerald Parker. I'm from the Institute of Canadian Justice. And if you like this T-shirt, they're on sale out in the lobby with the Lake Ontario Waterkeepers. Thank you for being here for the last few days. It has been some dark days here in Canada for science and social justice and evidence-based decision-making in Canada. It's refreshing to see the resilience of you wonderful folks and your success stories. Your work is telling. It's a telling testament of binational cooperation. I want to thank you all for that. Today is 2016, and Canada's federal leadership has signaled and announced a different tone of the dark days of the past. Our Prime Minister himself paddles our rivers and our lakes, and he's been out there with Daddy, and he's taken his kids. So we're seeing infrastructure dollars. We're seeing sewer plants, coastal reconstruction projects, 150th legacy projects like the 2017 Waterfront Festival in Whitby, Ontario. It's a watershed moment for all of us. These are brighter days, but there are some dark clouds in the horizon, and they are storming somewhere else. The progress report, first of all, and I'm going to your four questions, it tells us much. It's a lot of evidence, and it's based upon sound science. We need more of it. We really do, but we also need to share it. Please, and now I'm going to go to three recommendations. We need to talk about and emphasize upon the importance of the challenge that groundwater degradation does provide for us. We need to provide sub-indicators and correlations, and this will enable and talk about quality and quantity. To not speak about the depleted groundwater tables impacting much of our pollutants, our wetlands, our watershed sustainability and lake levels is missing the plot. More attention to this full cycle has to be provided. Avoiding corporatist interests, perhaps, plundering like pirates, our groundwater savings account, as someone said yesterday, has to be addressed and resolved. It's not an insulated or isolated situation. This is a continental issue. Let's not be divided and conquered. Let's ensure that the Great Lakes is not a port of call for predatory pirates. Second recommendation. civic action and engagement. Is this on? Civic? Okay.
Yep, that's fine.
And I will wrap up as quickly as I can. Please bear with me. We need much more of it. Everyone has spoken about it. We need to engage our tribes, our First Nations and Indigenous folk, our youth, our schools, our communities. We need to have these sectors, the people, the power, and the professionals, all these jurisdictions together, working together so that we can hear and support each other. I know municipalities and associations across Ontario would like to be here today, but they can't afford it. We need to bridge that gap and provide the funding. This will only happen if we enable them to be here to speak about those priorities. And yes, folks like us can and do say things that even you folks can't. We can speak about pirates and Nestle in the same sentence. You folks can't. We can't. So let us do our work, okay? So
I see that you've got quite a bit more, but what I'd like to suggest is that it might be helpful if you put that into a further submission even today and give it to us in writing, and I think that'll be very, very powerful and very helpful because we do want to hear all that you have to say, but we're running a little bit in difficulty here if we want to get to the rest of the folks.
Please bear with me for 20 seconds because I'd just like to finish my last recommendation and conclude.
Shall we give 20 seconds? I think so.
Is everyone good? Everyone good? Remember, this is on sale in the lobby.
And one T-shirt if we do.
So groundwater degradation, okay, civic engagement, and pharmaceutical product in our water supply. We've got an opioid pandemic in this continent. We need to address that issue very, very clearly. We've got product out there that can kill elephants being put into our water system. Need to be about that. So to conclude, Canada, it's a different day. It's a different dollar, and it's a different tone. Let's engage that. Let's embrace it. Let's work together. Let's do two things, and I would ask everyone here to do these two things. Please go up to the Nestle link on some of us and add to the 285,000 signatures there. Secondly, please go and look at the Lake Ontario Waterkeepers 2016 Gala video. It's amazing. So let's stand together, let's do what we can, and please include folks like us on your subcommittees.
All right.
We got heart. We don't bite. We do nibble a little. But we got heart.
Well, we want one of those shirts.
Thank you. But
do write that out, and we'd like to have that.
Fair enough. Thank you.
Thank you. And so next we go to Jill Taylor. After that, Ellen and Mark McFadgen. So, Jill Taylor from SOS Great Lakes.
Is this on?
It is on, and picking you up.
All right. Thank you. I'm Jill Taylor, president of SOS Great Lakes, a binational organization dedicated to keeping the burial of radioactive nuclear waste out of the Great Lakes Basin. We're not anti-nuclear, but are deeply opposed to the reckless plan of Ontario Power Generation to construct a deep geological repository for low and intermediate level waste on the shore of Lake Huron. The burial of this radioactive nuclear waste could result in the continuous risk of radiotoxic poisoning of Lake Huron, the whole of the Great Lakes, and the St. Lawrence River system. It should be of concern to this forum for at least five reasons. Reason one, radionuclides are persistently destructive. Two, multiple violations of the Canadian Environmental Assessment Act. Three, deeply flawed science. Four, flaunting of obligations to consult adequately with the United States. And five, every DGR in the world has failed. You said in your progress report that you're interested in chemicals that are persistent. No substance is more persistent than radionuclides in combination with our lake water. Over 100,000 years extends the definition of persistence and cannot be ignored. International experts have consistently derided the science and lack of common sense of a DGR on the Great Lakes, saying that it will not be able to contain radioactive nuclear waste or prevent the contamination of the ecosystem, including the lakes and the people around it. Yet the Ontario and Canadian governments continue to allow consideration of this plan, and you have remained silent on it. In a direct affront to the CEAA, OPG refused to consider alternate sites in addition to the sedimentary geology of the nearshore environment of the Bruce. OPG has stated that not only will the DGR leak, but their stormwater management system to protect the groundwater of Lake Huron is totally insufficient to handle extreme weather events. They also failed to consider climate change in relation to Great Lakes weather and the effect on future emergency management and control. Thousands of pages of testimony were read into the record by Canadian and American citizens and politicians from Canada and the United States, as well as nuclear scientists and Indigenous people and doctors, that refuted the logic and safety of the proposal for the dump on the shore of Lake Huron in the 2013 and 14 hearings on the environmental hearings. Excuse me. Every day, new evidence emerges exposing more faults in the OPG-DGR science and its woefully inadequate plan. In conclusion, we ask that the Canadian and U.S. governments work together to stop the DGR plan, a plan that was and is ill-conceived and does not follow the obligations of the environmental protection which you so proudly speak of in this forum. By doing so, you will join more than 154 municipalities that have signed a petition against the plan, the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence mayors who have thrice passed resolutions against the plan, 98% of all Canadians and Americans who responded to a letter-writing campaign initiated by the Canadian government in September 2015. We urge the Executive Committee of the Great Lakes Forum to list radionuclides as a chemical mutual concern and immediately act to oppose the OPG plan for a nuclear waste dump in Kincardine, Ontario. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jill. And I would now call on Ellen Daly, who's the director of SOS Great Lakes. So I'm presuming you're not reading the same message. And after that, Marty McFadgen and Molly Flanagan. So first of all, let's start with Ellen.
Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Ellen Daly. I'm from Erie, Pennsylvania. I'm a board-certified obstetrician-gynecologist and a director of SOS Great Lakes. As we've heard, a number of challenges continue to threaten the sustainability of the Great Lakes. Among these are toxic chemicals, including legacy contaminants and substances of emerging concern. Some of these toxics were included in the first list of chemicals of mutual concern, but there was at least one important omission: radionuclides. According to the EPA and Environment Canada, chemicals of mutual concern are those that originate from anthropogenic sources and that are agreed to by both countries as being potentially harmful to human health or the environment. Yesterday, I brought to your attention two reports from the 1990s that were prepared for the IJC about radionuclides in the Great Lakes. Today, I would like to elaborate on this topic and present why radionuclides should be included in Annex 3. The inventory of radionuclides in the Great Lakes report concluded that radionuclides were present in the Great Lakes and that the majority of the radionuclides were from anthropogenic sources. The reports also concluded that radionuclides are persistent, bioavailable, toxic, and have the potential to bioaccumulate and bioconcentrate. Regarding their toxicity, a recent review of the CNSC, World Health Organization, and American Cancer Society websites point out that exposure to ionizing radiation carries health risks, and that some populations, such as women, children, and the fetus, are more sensitive to the effects of radiation exposure than other groups. These health risks include cancer, hereditary effects, cataracts, cardiovascular disease and stroke, immune effects, premature aging, radiation sickness, and death. Leukemia, a type of cancer that arises in the bone marrow, and thyroid cancer are among the most common radiation-induced cancers. The thyroid gland normally takes up iodine, and bone takes up strontium. Each of these elements has a radioactive isotope produced by nuclear fission and is found in the Great Lakes. Perhaps less well known are the potential hereditary effects of ionizing radiation. These include congenital malformation, cognitive impairment, microcephaly, growth restriction of the fetus, prematurity, infertility, and pregnancy loss. Exposure to radionuclides may also increase the risk for cancers and other health problems in future generations due to the subtle ongoing biological impacts that may become pronounced and irreversible over time through genetic mutations. Human activities, both historic and current, have altered and will continue to impact the Great Lakes ecosystem. Radionuclides are present in the Great Lakes and are persistent and toxic. They clearly meet the criteria for inclusion in the list of chemicals of mutual concern. We ask the Canadian and U.S. governments to work together and do the right thing to protect and restore the Great Lakes. Add radionuclides to the list of chemicals of mutual concern. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Feel free to leave us a copy if you'd like. So, thank you. And next we have Marty McFadgen. chair of the Enver Huron Committee.
I'm here.
Uh-huh.
I'm leaving you.
And Molly, I think if you're next up.
So thank you.
Please go ahead, Marty.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen of the International Joint Commission, and also welcome to all of the participants who are at this very important forum. My name is Marty McFadgen, and I represent a group of citizens who live 5 kilometers from the Bruce Nuclear Site, which is the proposed location for the nuclear waste repository. Before speaking directly to our concerns about this project, I would like to tell you a little bit about who we are and how we came to be opposed to the project by Ontario Power Generation to build a nuclear repository on the shores of Lake Huron to permanently bury low-level and intermediate-level nuclear waste from all of Ontario's power plants. We are citizens of the previously named hamlet of Inverhuron, which has now been incorporated into the municipality of Kincardine. We are made up of both seasonal and permanent residents who live right along the shoreline of Inverhuron Bay. Our residents trace their heritage back 4, 5, and 6 generations. In early days, they drew their water directly from the lake via sand points in front of their homes. More recently, they have relied on deep wells cut into the aquifers that run inland from the lake. Therefore, water quality has been an integral part of our life along the shoreline. For that reason, our community incorporated the Inverhuron Committee because we have a large stake in ensuring that no radioactive materials can leak into the lake as a result of the project. However, it wasn't long before our research widened beyond the shoreline because this potential repository would affect, in fact, more than 40 million people along the shores of the Great Lakes should a human error, malfunction, severe weather, or act of terrorism occur. This would be the contamination of the drinking water of a disastrous magnitude. Our concern about leakage was reinforced during the joint review panels of 2013 and 2014 when the Ontario Power Generation indicated that when leakage occurred, radionuclides would be sufficiently dissolved in the waters of the Great Lakes. There is no dilution sufficiency when we look at the importance of our fresh water. As the caretakers of this precious resource, we cannot take a chance. We soon learned in our research that this would be the first repository to be built in limestone, which is a karst-susceptible geology, and that the only other 2 functioning repositories of this type have indeed leaked into the groundwater in Europe and have been closed down. In 2014, another repository leaked in New Carlsbad, New Mexico, and it has been closed and unable to be entered. Our journey soon led us to realize why this area had been chosen, because the municipality had agreed to host the repository and were given compensation of $35 million. There was a survey done in the community, not a referendum, and the telephone question that was asked was a very general nature. The seasonal residents were obviously not included. Our group believes that a small community of 12,000 people should not have the power to decide where Canada and how Canada disposes of its toxic waste. Please take a more global view of this situation and fill in guidelines and policies that will help us bury this or put this nuclear waste in a safe place. Thank you.
Thank you. The Molly Flanagan, Vice President of the Alliance for the Great Lakes. And next we'll have Eugene Bourgeois and Nancy Gocher.
Hi.
I said that right?
Molly Flanagan with the Alliance for the Great Lakes. Thank you for this opportunity to speak. I'm going to focus my comments on Lake Erie and ballast water, annexes 4 and 5. First on Lake Erie, we're pleased that the governments have adopted nutrient reduction targets for Lake Erie. We're concerned that the domestic action plans will rely on voluntary adoption of agricultural best management practices, which have been unsuccessful in reducing pollution from farms enough to curb toxic algae. The domestic action plans must include programs, policies, and protections that will successfully meet nutrient reduction targets. Without these, the domestic action plans will fail to achieve the 40% reduction goal, just as voluntary attempts to control nutrient pollution have failed elsewhere across the country. In addition to developing the domestic action plans, the Alliance calls on US EPA to develop an enforceable TMDL for US Lake Erie waters and an equivalent plan by Environment Canada for Canadian waters. We've asked Ohio and Michigan to declare the open waters of Western Lake Erie as impaired under the Clean Water Act. It's glaringly obvious that these waters are impaired under federal law. While a TMDL is not a panacea, it's the most effective tool we have under U.S. law that can help solve Lake Erie's problems. And now briefly on ballast water, stopping invasive species before they enter the Great Lakes is critical to the health of the lakes. And ballast water is the primary way in which they've gotten into the Great Lakes. Mm-hmm. We're pleased that EPA is regulating ballast water under the Clean Water Act. EPA's new rules should require using the best technology available, include numeric standards, consider onshore treatment options, and cover all classes of vessels. We're concerned by efforts in the U.S. Congress to undermine the Clean Water Act protections through legislation like the Vessel Incidental Discharge Act. We have and will continue to stridently oppose efforts to weaken ballast water protections. Finally, I know there's a lot of focus on celebrating successes this week, and I'm as fond of a celebration as the next person. We should celebrate the progress we've made cleaning up our legacy of contamination and be encouraged by the localized improvements made in coastal cities. However, these successes are not the entire Great Lakes story. People across the region are at risk of contaminated drinking water, and the benefits of the Great Lakes are not shared equitably. I fear that there's a general lack of urgency in addressing some of these critical threats to the Great Lakes and the people who call them home. This week, we're spending a lot of time on process. The real measure of progress are the actions we take to ensure that the Great Lakes are reliable sources of drinking water, recreational opportunities, and support a strong economy. Thank you.
Thank you, Molly. Eugene Bourgeois. Aha. And Nancy, and then Sandy.
Good afternoon. My name is Eugene Bourgeois, and I'm a retired sheep farmer living in Huron, home to both a nuclear power plant and the proposed deep geologic repository for low and intermediate level waste right here beside and below Lake Huron. Surprising to me that radionuclides are not already chemicals of mutual concerns in the Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement under Annex 3, as recommended by your own nuclear task force 20 years ago. We learned in the late 1880s that when we use our rivers as sewers, innocent people die. We were reminded of this recently when Walkerton's water was contaminated by farm sewage and a number of people died. In each case, the solution to pollution was believed to be dilution. The National Academy of Sciences has established that there are no known safe concentrations of exposure to radionuclides and so has adopted a linear no-threshold standard. The recent KIC study in Europe demonstrated the strong statistical correlation between exposure to chronic low doses of ionizing radiation and childhood leukemia, effects that increase the closer one lives to a nuclear power plant, even when these are operating as permitted. Even without this, we still manage to be exposed to the harmful effects of chronic low doses of radiation from both cosmic and solar sources, each of which can cause sickness and death. During the hearings for the DGR, we learned that OPG's long-term plans for this radioactivity is for it to be discharged into the groundwater and from there to Lake Huron. It claims this won't happen for a million years, similar to WIPP's claims. WIPP failed catastrophically after only 15 years. In the 1950s, expectant mothers were X-rayed to determine the relative health of their babies. It was only after Alice Stewart organized the Oxford Survey in England and analyzed the data statistically that she showed X-raying fetuses itself led to early childhood death. Buster Brown shoes offered to X-ray your feet when I was a child, and many of those adolescent boys who did so then are sterile today. The Great Lakes are a source of drinking water for more than 40 million Americans and Canadians. Water is something each of us needs every day of our lives. Mothers need it to mix baby food for their children. It was a mere 75 years ago that we first split the atom, setting the stage for nuclear power production. In every case, our initial concerns about the impacts of exposure to ionizing radiation have been far too liberal to safeguard people. Radionuclides must be included as a chemicals of mutual concern under Annex 3. Without having a clearly identified understanding of them and their inventories, we will not be able to research their potential adverse health effects on populations who live near and rely on the Great Lakes for water. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone feel free to write us, so don't feel constrained on that respect. Next, I would call forward Nancy, and then Sandy, and then Ray Bush.
Hi, thank you. I'm Nancy Gauthier with Freshwater Future. Thanks very much for taking time to listen. So first of all, I want to recognize how lucky we are to have the Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement. Some of my friends in the Lake Winnipeg jurisdiction are very jealous of our Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement. Yes. I know lots of people are jealous over various things. My U.S. colleagues are jealous over the Canada-Ontario Agreement. Us Canadians are jealous of the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative. So I think that there's lots of progress we can make. The Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement has been really important in a number of ways. It's helped us, you know, establish pathways to addressing threats. It's helped us collaborate across regions to work together to address, to create solutions. And it's been a way of justifying investment in the resources to protect this water. I think this is really important when we face a lot of really serious threats. And our challenge is to be very thorough with our science and with public consultation while being quick enough to respond to threats that are happening right now. And, you know, I think that given the level of threats we have with algal blooms in Lake Erie, you know, we really need to stress the urgency of reacting much more quickly. We have the largest algal bloom ever recorded was in 2011, and then that record was again broken in 2015. And in 2014, we've had hundreds of thousands of residents without clean drinking water because of the algal blooms. If this is not a call to action, I don't know what is. And here we stand in 2016, and all we really have is targets to address the nutrient, the phosphorus. So I get it. It takes time to develop the science. It takes time to develop the plans. And I'm waiting for these plans to be released, and I'm really waiting and eager to see what's going to be in these plans. But, you know, because I'm willing to wait, I really need these, like we, as in I think everybody, really want to see these plans to have some real solutions in them. These solutions need to add up to the 40% targets that have been put in there. I'm going to list four things that I think these plans need to have. So the first is the solutions need to add up to 40% reduction in phosphorus. There needs to be some new innovative ideas and approaches and solutions in there. The same old solutions that we're using today aren't going to be enough to get us to the degree of change that we need. The third is that the solutions need to be proportional to the sources of the pollution, and that means that a lot of these solutions need to directly address non-point source agricultural pollution. And the fourth and final point is that there needs to be some triggers in there. So if we're noticing that we're not quite meeting the 40% reduction targets, we need to ratchet up our solutions and do more than what we were doing previously. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Nancy. Sandy. Sandy Greer, writer, filmmaker, educator at Awakening to Possibility.
Yes, thank you. Yes, I see myself mainly as an educator and also one of John's on-the-ground citizen activists, as many of my previous friends and neighbors have presented themselves. My name is Dr. Sandy Greer, and I am one more citizen who wants to advocate strongly for the inclusion of radionuclides as chemicals of mutual concern. It is overdue, and yet it is absolutely imperative at this time. I have been one of the interveners at two public hearings to fight against the proposal of a deep geologic repository near the shoreline of Lake Huron, which is totally outrageous because the science is not there. And I would like to point out that I am very happy to see that all of your annexes and several of your priorities for science in action fit beautifully with the need right now to include radionuclides. For example, in your science in action document of 2016, the IJC advocates provide an early warning for chemicals that could become chemicals of mutual concern. And this is why studies are needed immediately to be done, because they have not been done properly. And I must say, and I'm sad to say this, that the nuclear industry cannot be trusted, because I was shocked with what was said and what was not stated during many weeks of two public hearings in 2013 and 2014. I was reading science documents, and I continue to do so to be up to date on international science, and even the International Commission for Radiological Protection, in its 2014 document, pointed out that globally, the nuclear industry is in the early years of beginning to figure out how to measure radionuclides in the natural environment. And what the ICRP has been doing is creating a reference study similar to what was done for human beings. But even the ICRP is being criticized constructively by fellow organizations such as the International Union of Radio Ecology, who points out that the representation of animals and plants as symbolic organisms is totally insufficient, that what is needed is an ecosystem approach. And so I commend the IJC that this is where you're at, and God bless you, because the nuclear industry is not there yet to recognize, and most specifically in Canada, that we need to undertake an ecosystem approach. But we are seriously challenged, because what I have learned as a citizen is that we cannot rely only on computer models, because even different computer models done at different scales, from say a single organism to a landscape scale, will come up with different and contradictory results about the impacts of radionuclides. But not only that, computer models must not be solely relied upon. It is really imperative to also include field testing and laboratory testing and put everything together. But this needs to be done now, and many of these studies done, and to find independent scientists to do these studies so we get closer to the truth of the actual potential dangerous impact on the environment. And meanwhile, your work will influence the federal government, I hope, to stop any licensing for the DGRs until a lot more factual science is available.
Well, thank you, Sandy. I think if there are more things to say, do file with us. You're a writer. we'll get more. Thank you. And next, I would call on Ray Bush. Ray Bush may be in the parking lot. And next, Andrew McCammon. Thank you, Andrew. And next would be Christine Elwell, and then Garth White.
Thank you. Thank you very much for being here and listening to our comments. If I may, I just want to respond to the chair's comment about the system being rigged, because I was just on the phone and Mike Pence denied he said it. First of all, I am Andrew McCammon, the executive director of the Ontario Headwaters Institute. We are Ontario's leading NGO working on, NGO in Ontario working on protecting headwaters and advocating for integrated watershed management. I have four succinct messages for you today. First of all, I thought the 2016 report was excellent. there is some progress, but I'm more hopeful over the fact that it seems that there is a lot more progress on the immediate horizon, something we've been working for 25 years. So congratulations. Two, please stop calling the lakes variants of the largest freshwater ecosystem in the world. This is simply not true. The first two versions of the Ontario Great Lakes Protection Act contained that phrase. The third version, which was finally successfully passed, deleted that phrase as a result of our bringing to the attention of the ministry that this was not the case. Since then, we've had correspondence from the Ministry of Natural Resources and Forestry and the Federal Minister of the Environment to similarly stop using the phrase. The term is obtuse and inaccurate, and it devalues your overall science credibility. Three, we urge you to find a better balance between your efforts on the lakes and their watersheds. We thoroughly understand and support the hugely important science efforts focused on the lakes and the need to deal with both excessive municipal runoff and lakeside point source contributions to the lakes. However, and in spite of the mandate, the restricted mandate of the recent climate change study, which is informative, because it says that they're only allowed to talk about the receiving waters, the lakes, and the connecting channels, and not talk at all about the watersheds, the fact is that too many dead trees, dried out wetlands, too many nutrients, and increased temperatures from thousands of tributaries that contribute 48% of the annual inflow to the lakes will cause challenges that cannot be ignored. Four, we ask you to consider recommending to the parties to commit to protecting the basin by adopting minimal thresholds to protect natural heritage. One set of such targets can be found in an Environment Canada publication called How Much Habitat is Enough, which was the basis for the OHI's recent submissions of the first set of targets under the Ontario Great Lakes Protection Act. We will not take up our time and go over by stating what those are, but we will send them to you, and thank you so much.
Please do. Thank you, Andrew. Christine Elwell, and then Garth, and then Mike Ripley.
Thank you very much. My name's Christine Elwell. I'm with Sierra Club Canada Green Energy Campaign. I'd like to read into the record our letter signed by over 27 NGOs, including Sierra Club US, and a growing number of groups, both sides of the border, about the proposed shipment of 150 truckloads of highly radioactive liquid nuclear waste from Chalk River near Ottawa down to South Carolina, which is now bracing for Hurricane Matthew, cross bridges and roads, including the Peace Bridge in Buffalo. I provide copies. I anticipated your need for materials.
Well, thank you.
And I have extra copies here for people. I provide you with these copies. It's a letter to the Prime Minister and President, as well as honorable commissioners and other agencies, including the Great Lakes Executive Committee, with excerpts from the 2012 Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement and the mandate of the Executive Committee. We're posting this on your website. It's on the Sierra Club Canada website as well. And we had a press conference Monday at Queen's Park. It was very well attended. This issue is getting a lot of pickup in the South media in particular. We request that the parties in the Great Lakes Executive Committee cancel or delay this radioactive shipment until notice has been given under Article 6 of the 2012 Great Lakes, there's excerpts there, Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement, and full and meaningful consultation with state, federal, provincial governments, First Nations, municipalities, and the public. That includes a consideration of environmental impact assessment in both countries, and that examines impacts and cumulative impact effects. Alternatives are available. The science is there. We can solidify this liquid nuclear waste on site. There's no need to transport it all the way through the Great Lakes. The theme...
Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
The theme of the IJC's meeting is about how well are we doing, and our assessment of the progress so far is disappointing given this example of this highly radioactive waste. The theme of the 2012 amendments to the agreement were to anticipate, prevent, and respond to threats to the waters. You'll see this in Article 2 of the 2012 agreement. Further, the goal to anticipate, prevent, and respond to threats, the parties set out notice and response obligations in Article 6. Article 6 says the parties acknowledge the importance of anticipating, preventing, and responding to threats, and they commit to the following notification response. Sub A and B are about pollution incidents. Paragraph C, however, is to anticipate activities that could lead to significant impact on the waters. And then there's a list of activities. Guess which one is number one? Mm-hmm. Number one is nuclear storage and transport of radioactive materials.
Well, now we've run out of time, but listen, you have a very copious brief here, and we are trying to address the issues that probably 6 or 8 months from now we will report on. So
it could I wrap up in 1 minute?
I think you could wrap up in 15 seconds.
So we call upon the executive committee and parties to cancel or delay the shipment until there's meaningful consultation, environmental impact assessment, including alternatives. And we gave the government 30 days to respond.
Well, thank you. So I want to call up Garth White, Mark Ripley, Mike Ripley, I should say, and Bob Duncanson. And well, let's start with Garth White.
Hi, my name is Garth White, and I'm President and CEO of Fertilizer Canada. And thank you very much for the opportunity to give our statement. We have an on-the-ground solution that will help reduce phosphorus runoff to the Great Lakes. Fertilizer Canada was encouraged with the 2016 progress report of the parties, which on page 47 cited 4R nutrient stewardship as an internationally recognized approach based on core scientific principles to improve nutrient use efficiency to reduce any potential nutrients loss into the environment. As well, the report highlighted the activities that have successfully been implemented over the past year under the Memorandum of Cooperation between Fertilizer Canada, the Government of Ontario, and the Ontario Agribusiness Association. We're also encouraged that the International Joint Commission issued a report on phosphorus in Lake Erie, which endorses 4R nutrient stewardship as an important opportunity to improve fertilizer use in watersheds and increase water quality. The Canadian fertilizer industry is committed to delivering science-based programs that produce results that are environmentally, socially, and economically responsible. And one of the core principles of our programming is sustainability. Our industry is committed to working with those who live, work, and farm in the Great Lakes region. Fertilizer Canada supports the need to protect the ecological health of the Great Lakes, including Lake Erie, by continuing the industry's extensive research, programming, and awareness-building initiatives. The Ontario Memorandum of Cooperation commits a combined contribution of $350,000 to protect water quality and support the sustainable intensification of the agriculture in the region. 4R nutrient stewardship is a science-based approach that ensures that nutrients are applied using the right source at the right rate, time, and place through the adoption of best management practices to achieve economic, social, and environmental sustainability. We want fertilizer to go to the plants, not to water. 4R nutrient stewardship optimizes the efficiency of fertilizer use. Properly managed fertilizer supports cropping systems that provide economic, social, and environmental benefits. On the other hand, poorly managed nutrient applications can decrease profitability and increase nutrient losses, potentially degrading water and air. The fertilizer industry recognizes that there is a need to find solutions that address environmental concerns, and 4R nutrient stewardship is the industry's solution. And as I was listening over the last couple of days, especially with Susan and Tinka's excellent presentation on phosphorus in Lake Erie, I was thinking there's a disconnect often between science and action, and there's a disconnect between our 10 years of science and implementation of the 4R nutrient program. And what we recommend is in the future that the progress report of the party should address this issue and identify that a coordinated approach between governments and stakeholders is needed to increase awareness and to identify approaches that will encourage and support growers to practice for our nutrient stewardship. We're enormously proud of the results that have come out of our research over the last 10 years with partners, NGOs, governments, academia, and conservation groups across North America. And we look forward to furthering our relationship with the International Joint Commission and both government and U.S. governments in addressing this very important issue. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's a bit of a hiatus at this moment. We are halfway through the list of people who have indicated to us online and perhaps even some additional ones to speak. And so we're going to try and do the Solomon on the baby here. And we have a 7 o'clock meeting downtown, as Mike Goffin told you earlier today, when we will meet with the citizens of Toronto who are coming in to speak to us. And that makes it a bit difficult for some of us, but we decided we will just divide ourselves in half. And so Commissioner Moy and I will withdraw, and now you'll get the services of a much better chair who is going to look after the balance of this discussion, and every word will be taken down and properly received. But would you excuse us? I want to thank you very much, and we all thank you. But in the meantime, Commissioner Moy and I will go off and do our duties at the Toronto City Hall. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Gord, and thanks to everyone here for really presenting clearly and sticking to the time and making some very compelling comments that we indeed will take seriously. This is recorded, so the people who are not here will hear the comments that are going to be made. We have this room for 55 more minutes, so it's a bit, and then we have no more control in this room. So, you'll pass, Catherine? Okay, but put it in writing. Thank you, and you do that very well. I know that. Okay, so we're with Mr. Ripley. Yes, sir.
Only half a crew, but that's okay.
Okay.
My name is Mike
Ripley. I won't make any comments on whether you have the better half.
Okay, I'm sure I do. Mike Ripley, I'm the environmental coordinator for the Chippewa Ottawa Resource Authority, CORA in Sault Ste. Marie, which is comprised of five Native American tribes that have treaty rights in the 1836 treaty in Michigan. Those tribes are the Bay Mills Indian Community, the Grand Traverse Band of Ottawa and Chippewa Indians, the Little River Band of Ottawa Indians, the Little Traverse Bay Bands of Ottawa Indians, and the Sault Ste. Marie Tribe of Chippewa Indians, and I am a member of the Sault Ste. Marie Tribe of Chippewa Indians. I'm very honored to be on the Water Quality Board, but I'm here today to talk about a specific threat to the Great Lakes, and that threat is an oil pipeline beneath the Mackinac Straits, the Enbridge Line 5 oil pipeline. That pipeline was built in 1953, and millions of gallons of crude oil flow through it every day. That's 63 years, and it extends a distance of 4.6 miles through some of the most treacherous waters in the Great Lakes. And I say treacherous because the Straits of Mackinac have very strong currents and unpredictable currents. Modeling of an oil spill there shows that the oil travels not only into Lake Huron, but into Lake Michigan and into all the islands and the bays. And also treacherous because in a normal winter, that Straits of Mackinac is covered in ice for 3 months. And even the Coast Guard, U.S. Coast Guard, says it would be almost impossible to clean up an oil spill if it occurred in the winter. CORA is especially concerned about this pipeline if it ruptures. Over 50% of our commercial fishery occurs in those waters. That is the heart of our treaty area, the heart of the Great Lakes, arguably. So hundreds of families would be impacted if tribal members would be impacted if Line 5 ruptured. And as we saw in Prince William Sound in Alaska, after the Exxon Valdez spill, toxins from an oil spill will remain in the water and in the sediments for decades, affecting the reproduction of fish in that area. As we've seen from reports we've heard during the last few days, our fisheries have already been impacted negatively by invasive species like sea lamprey and zebra mussels. An oil spill in the Straits of Mackinac would be a tragedy for us all, and it's not a matter of if, but when. So I'm asking the IJC and the governments of Canada and the United States to take decisive action and shut down Line 5 for good.
Thank you very much.
We know well the file.
Yeah, thank you. Bob Duncanson and then Aaron Mahoney, followed by Taylor Hollis.
Thank you, Chair. Sir. I'm Bob Duncanson. I'm the Executive Director of the Georgian Bay Association, which is an umbrella group for 19 cottage associations on the eastern shore and northern shore of Georgian Bay. We represent 3,100 families on the bay. When we read the progress report, and to answer the question, are you on target, it's very difficult to be on target when there's so many moving parts. We heard clearly over the past 2 days the amount of science that is evolving constantly on this file, but also there are new and emerging threats. And when I get into some of the obvious things that we're missing in the progress report, we've already heard quite a bit about the chemicals of mutual concern and radionuclides and plastics, ingredients and antibacterial ingredients and personal care products, pharmaceuticals. They're all real and what people are talking about on the bay and need to be addressed sooner than later. Phragmites. Phragmites wasn't in the habitat annex in the progress report, but clearly we heard a lot about it in the past 2 days. I want to point out a bit of a disconnect in the Canadian side. The Canadian government has invested some seed money to help local groups like some of our associations and some NGOs do eradication programs for Phragmites, but at the same time they haven't got their Parks Canada people in the game. So in Honey Harbour we're eradicating on private land. Bosley National Park, the National Georgian Bay Park, aren't engaged, and they've got large Phragmites sites. So there's disconnects in the government. Another disconnect in the government has to do with the dealing with nutrients. We heard a lot about what's happening with nutrients and phosphorus specifically in Lake Erie. We have nutrient loading problems in Georgian Bay. It boggles our mind. We've been very frustrated around fish farming, and we heard it a little bit from our First Nations person earlier, who asked the question, what about fish farming? Fish farming in Georgian Bay and Lake Huron contributes 55 tons of phosphorus directly into the water, public waters, every year. That's a point source that could be easily dealt with if there was the political will to move those into closed containment. The last point I want to touch on is something that was brought up earlier about community engagement. The government doesn't have enough resources, man or money, to put get enough science going on the ground to do enough nearshore measurements and whatnot. We could enlist an army of volunteers. Cottagers are very vested in protecting their area. And with a little bit of direction and framework from the government, maybe a little seed money, maybe not, you could get a lot of volunteer work out there in the field almost immediately without having to wait for annexes and lamps and whatnot. Get us to work. Put the challenge to us. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Aaron Mahoney? Yes, thank you. Followed by Taylor Hollis, followed by Pamela Tababadung. I think I have that right, I hope. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Aaron Mahoney, and I'm the Commissioner of Environmental Services for York Region, which is located due north of the City of Toronto. Wanted to share a few comments with you this afternoon, which I hope will inform your advice to the governments of our two nations on the Great Lakes. York Region supplies safe water and wastewater services to our current population, approximately 1.2 million people, growing to 2041 to 1.8 million people, with 50,000 businesses across the region right now. We have a strong invested interest in protecting the health of the Great Lakes, and I think that's underpinned by our investment over the last decade of some $3.7 billion in water and wastewater infrastructure. Our communities, the region is unique. Our communities are serviced by both Lake Ontario water as well as water from Lake Simcoe, which is part of the Lake Huron watershed. And our uniqueness is in the sense that we're the only regional municipality in the Greater Toronto Area which does not have direct access to Lake Ontario for our water supply. So we do maintain long-term service agreements with our partners, Peel, Durham, the City of Toronto, for various aspects of our service needs. We see across the Great Lakes Basin, water services continue to face greater regulatory complexity. And this is especially true for our region, which is subject to both the provincial-wide regulatory regime and additional requirements that reflect our unique geography at the headwater of rivers and streams draining to both Lake Simcoe and Lake Ontario. The regulatory landscape and these requirements are really important considerations as we think about our future and servicing growth within the region. Recently, we've adopted a recognition that water in all its forms is valuable and needs to be considered under a one water approach to make sure that our services are more sustainable through a better consideration of integrative thinking and innovative solutions. I think the municipal water system has traditionally been thought of as, you know, various isolated components, but if we can unlock more value through integrative thinking about water management, I think that will help us in the years to come in ensuring our systems are more sustainable. In looking at the progress report of the parties, I think it's clear that a significant binational effort has been made to increase the understanding of the algae problem in Lake Erie. I'd just share with you that understanding and quantifying all the sources of phosphorus and nutrients and evaluating source and non-point source management options, whether it's from municipal sources, industrial sources, agricultural sources, or stormwater runoff, is clear to success in managing phosphorus. We know that in 2011, a paper in the journal The Great Lakes Research said that all the Lake Ontario combined wastewater treatment plants in Canada and the U.S. contribute only a very minor percentage of the contribution of phosphorus to the loading in Lake Ontario. And the major sources of this nutrient originate from unregulated sources, including rivers, streams, storm outfalls, and airborne sources.
Thank you. So can you wrap up, please?
I will. Just one last sentence. Developing the management strategies that are effective for all these sources is going to require collaborative efforts from all the parties involved and a real openness to innovative solutions. Thank you
so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate that. Taylor Hollis? And then Pamela Tababandung, I'm going to get this, Tababandung, and then Bonnie McKilhenny. Thank you. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Taylor Hollis, and I'm here representing the Saginaw Chippewa Indian Tribe of Michigan as their watershed outreach coordinator. And during this conference, we've heard a lot about collaboration and partnerships over the last couple days. And I wanted to take this opportunity to highlight a few of the partnerships and collaborative efforts that have allowed us to improve the water quality in Lake Huron from a headwaters down approach. And the Saginaw Chippewa Indian Tribe is located in central lower Michigan. And we have our reservation there in Isabella County. And we also have some properties and territories along the Saginaw Bay and throughout the Lake Huron watershed. So we've been really proactive in the community to get projects done and to be the lead on partnerships to finish those projects. We have funding through the EPA, and like I said, a lot of our projects take a headwaters down approach. The few of the rivers that run through the reservation eventually end up in Saginaw Bay. And some of the objectives that we focus on are E. coli in the rivers, and we have done some studies on DNA to address sources of E. coli if they're bovine or human, and we've actually found a lot of the E. coli in the river comes from leaking or failing septic systems. So we're working with local municipalities to address those issues and try and decrease the amount of E. coli in the rivers. We also work with farmers to address local nutrient problems. And we really want to collaborate with other agencies so that we can get these projects done as efficiently as possible. Through GLRI and the U.S. Forest Service, we're working with the local county and city agencies to address the ash trees that have been basically run out by the emerald ash borer. And we're replacing those so that we can reduce runoff, erosion, and sediment and nutrient input to the local streams and rivers. And we're also doing native vegetation plantings along areas of the Ross stream banks. In terms of invasive species through GLRI, we're also working to hire expertise to address invasive species within the tribal boundary and around tribal properties. Our wildlife biologist works closely with the Cooperative Invasive Species Management Area, or the CISMA, to identify and treat invasive species around federal, tribal, and state support as well. We work closely with agricultural producers in the area to address those nutrient problems and through pilot projects on impaired sections of the streams. We do that through our Clean Water Act Section 319 program and BIA Forestry to do stream bank restoration using tree revetment and a floodplain restoration approach to allow infiltration and water retention to help slow the flow of water into impaired streams. And that's all I have.
And I would like to say thank you, not just for your submission, but also for all that contribution on the ground.
Thank you for letting me comment.
Sure.
Thank you.
Next up is the Miss Pamela, whose name I've butchered, and she may not be here. Okay, let's go to Bonnie McElhinney. And she's not here either. Then we're looking for Mike Wilton, Keith Brooks, and Kevin Rich, in that order. Are any of those people here? Aha.
I'm the second in the order.
Well, you may be first if we don't have Mike Wilton. Oh, all right. Then I will read it out, and then you can be. It's a written statement. He has to have it be read out. I think that's fair enough. It's a short. After, hang on, let me get my instructions here.
Don't start the paddle yet.
Okay. It's about Belgian gray water. Yes. After having diligently searched the internet, I've been unable to locate any reference to legislation regarding the treatment of gray water or bilge water in Canadian waters. From a practical point of view, I realize that strong either gray or bilge water in an onboard facility is probably impractical, particularly in the latter instance if you have a leaky boat. However, it seems to me that it should or must be legislated that all gray water and bilge water be filtered for noxious substances, such as petroleum products, prior to exhausting outside of the hull, or to be stored on board until suitable pump-out facilities can be accessed. Filter systems are available for smaller pleasure craft that are well within the disposable income of the average pleasure boater, but must be made compulsory if success is to be achieved. Do you plan to seek such legislation? If so, when? And that is his statement, Mike Wilton, who it indicated he couldn't be here previously. Thank you. So, Mr. Brooks.
Hi, thanks. I'm Keith Brooks with Environmental Defense Canada. We're a Canadian environmental charity. work a fair bit on the Great Lakes. I'm going to keep this short because of the lateness of the hour, but I just want to say to the IJC, I think if more attention could be paid to the issue of plastics, that would be a really good thing. This is a big issue in the oceans, obviously, and it's becoming a bigger issue in the lakes, too. They found, you know, 6 million pieces of plastic per square kilometer here in Lake Ontario, just outside Toronto. I don't know what the stats are like in U.S. cities, but I think it is a real issue for the Great Lakes and one that we can't ignore. And we great to see the IJC pay more attention to that issue. And then the other point I want to make is kind of through you to speak to government, which is that we're looking for these domestic action plans and all the things that governments are doing. I think it's a good time. Governments are taking all these kind of actions, but they need to put real dollars behind those actions. You know, Canadian government just announced, you know, they're going to do stuff around like Erie algae. They put $3 million in their budget. That's just not enough money, right? The whole Great Lakes budget for Ontario is $15 million. These are really, really small sums of money, not adequate for what's needed to bring about the actions that the governments are now committing to. So I just want to say that these action plans need to have, not just around algae, but around all the other issues. If governments are going to take action, they need to be putting dollars behind those actions. That's all. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'll just point out that on the issue of plastics, the IJC did host a workshop recently, and we brought together a number of different perspectives, people, experts, and we will be providing a report on that subject. Kevin Rich of Ducks Unlimited. Is Mr. Rich here? Yes. Thank you very much. Followed by Christy Meyer from Ohio Environmental Council. Let's see, Christy, but okay, please.
Good evening.
Thank you.
My name's Kevin Rich. I work with Ducks Unlimited here in Ontario. For those of you who don't know us, our business is wetland conservation for the benefit of waterfowl, other wildlife, and people. We've been doing that for 78 years across Canada and the United States. Our main message for you today is the Great Lakes need more wetlands. We know so much about wetland values and ecosystem services, whether it's flood mitigation, water quality improvement, or and specifically related to phosphorus, as well as carbon sequestration. But despite all that knowledge, despite all of our collective efforts, we still lose wetlands. And I can speak more from personal knowledge from my experience here in Ontario, where I live and work. We continue to lose wetlands. The rate of that loss seems to have declined, but the trend is still downward, and that's a very concern. And that's a downward trend not only in wetland area, but also in wetland function, and therefore benefits. So what's the solution? I think there's two overarching pieces that we need to work on collectively. Stronger policies to protect wetlands, and policies that require compensation or offsetting where wetland impacts are unavoidable. Secondly, we need higher investments by governments and others in wetland management. And I just want to elaborate a little bit more on where we think those investments are particularly needed. We strongly recommend that wetlands and other natural systems be considered as critical infrastructure and therefore be allocated infrastructure funding. The various ecological goods and services that wetlands and other habitat provide make them excellent candidates for funding as essential critical infrastructure. And related to that, municipalities need more tools and approaches, and better approaches, to better use nature as an infrastructure asset and allow it to provide critical services like flood control and carbon sequestration. Secondly, we need a complete up-to-date wetland inventory. We can't really track our progress on wetland management and conservation if we don't know where they all are and we don't accurately know where their boundaries are. Thirdly, we need more investment in measuring ecological goods and services. The old adage, you can't manage what you can't measure, is true for ecological goods and services as well. We have a good body of science, but we need to expand on that. And fourthly, and certainly not leastly, we need more investment on wetland restoration on the ground. Apologies. In Canada continues to lag behind the United States on a per capita basis in terms of annual investment in the Great Lakes. The Green Budget Coalition, of which our organization is part of, recommends that the Canadian government increase its funding commitment to the Great Lakes program to achieve greater progress under the 2012 protocol in support of implementation action to address nutrients and pollutants, achieving lake ecosystem targets, as well as other activities. So we strongly feel if we make those investments and we strengthen those policies concerning wetlands, we will get more wetlands and we'll get healthier wetlands, which as a result will create healthier and more resilient Great Lakes.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Appreciate that. And if you want to put any, you know, submit something in writing, that would be excellent too. Christy Meyer. I'm not seeing Christy Meyer. Jim Hudson, followed by Don McCabe. Are either of those gentlemen here? How about I'm sorry?
Don's here.
Oh, very good. Mr. McCabe. Followed by Vernon Surrett. Is Mr. Surrett here? Followed by Mary Mutu. Okay, you may be next. Yes, Mr. McCabe.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. My name is Don McCabe. I'm a farmer down in Inwood, Ontario, which is part of Lambton County, which is eventually part of Lake Erie watershed directly, but the reality is it's part of the Great Lakes watershed. I also have the opportunity to currently serve as the president of the Ontario Federation of Agriculture, which represents 36,000 farmers from Manitoba to Quebec into Pelee Island. And the issue of the Great Lakes water quality is a grave concern to farmers in general. It's also a grave concern to have announcements, pronouncements, ideas, and concepts floated around without a full understanding of what it takes to be in agriculture today and what the realities are for the future. And therefore, my comments are aimed at helping us to structure how we look into the future. Comments have been made in these sessions around the area of climate change, and that to me is one of the most overarching priorities moving ahead. We're seeing 100-year storms now occur almost on a yearly basis. That's not a good thing. And the reality of being a farmer is that I can stand here and tell you I'm a cash crop farmer. The reality is that doesn't ring a lot for a number of people in this room. Because bottom line, for the grandfathers who are in agriculture today, when they leave the farm, there's only 1.4% of Canadians still farming. And why did I say grandfathers? It's because when the grandfathers of today saw their grandfathers leave the farm, we were using horsepower. When we were using that horsepower, 50% of Canadians were still farming. That's the amount of decade of change we've had in two generations. And the reality now is then that we're now in a very much of a systems analysis in agriculture. And when it comes to things like phosphorus, we do not go out and spill that stuff all over the place, and we're not going to go to the beach to visit it. It's supposed to be growing a crop. But with the issues of climate change and the volatility that we're now dealing with, we have tremendous issues ahead of us to be able to properly monitor and ensure that we're keeping our stuff where it needs to be. And that's why we endorse the issue of the 4-hour program directly on farms. It's why we're looking at cover crops. It's why we're looking at removing residues from our material to ensure a corn residue, because our corn yields are now high enough to ensure that we're not only feeding people, we're also going to ensure that we are able to bring you fuels and other things, because a food versus fuel debate is strictly an academic exercise. So in closing, I wish to offer that we have many things to bring to us, bring to the table. But there's only one rule in agriculture. Mother Nature wins. Do not regulate me into oblivion. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate that. Thank you for waiting to throughout the earlier speakers. Mary Muter, followed by John Curry. Mary, go ahead.
Thank you. Mary Muter, I'm chair of the Georgian Bay Great Lakes Foundation. I want to make a statement, and then I have a question for you. My statement is that we are opposed to wetlands offsetting, basically on principle. You cannot create a wetland that creates the ecological values that a natural wetland provides. And shoreline development should never be allowed to encroach and interfere with wetlands. And that lesson has been taught many times, with millions of dollars having been spent in trying to reestablish wetlands along Lake Ontario shorelines. You can never, ever return it to the original condition. So the second thing I have is, you probably heard me mention earlier today, our concern about the viable reproducing population of grass carp in the Sandusky River that drains into Lake Erie. My question for you is, and it's based on two things. One, obviously, Canadians, 77% of Canadians think Asian carp are already in the Great Lakes. And no wonder. There's a huge education component that needs to happen here. But I'm wondering, given the urgency of dealing with that reproducing population, and you should know that Department of Fisheries and Ocean and Ministry of Natural Resources staff have spoken to me and told me that they will put boats into the water down in the Sandusky River and send staff down to help eradicate that population. Is there any way that the IJC could send an urgent directive or advice to both governments asking that this problem be dealt with on an urgent basis? Because we were told on Monday at the Asian Carp Forum that they have a plan to deal with them in 2 years. That's way too far off into the future, given the threat that these fish pose to the Great Lakes. Is there any way that the IJC can ask for this to be dealt with in a much more expeditious manner? Thank you for being here, and thank you for taking the time.
Thank you very much. I will say this. Yes, we can send messages. No, we cannot send directives, but it's a good idea. I would love to get that authority to send directives to the government.
But you can provide advice.
But we do, indeed, and we take it seriously. So my rather light note about not being able to direct anybody is just that, a light note, but on a serious subject. Thank you so much.
Thank you
very much. John Curry. Carey. I'm sorry. That's an A. Is Mr. Carey here? No. Is there anybody else here who had not signed up who wishes to speak? Who has not spoken? You didn't speak. I'm sorry. Please, come forward. Yes. Sorry.
Sitting in the area where people are speaking.
No, and I've seen your smiling face, and I'm sorry. Yeah, and your name is?
Hi, my name's Stephanie Woodworth. I'm a student at the University of Toronto in the Exercise Sciences Department.
Thank you, Stephanie. Go ahead.
It's a two-part comment, I guess, addressing two gaps that I thought weren't addressed in this forum over the last 2 days. That is a call to action about the privatization of public water resources. This has not been a conversation. It needs to be a conversation. This is really important, and it affects the quality and quantity of our water resources. The second part, we talk about public engagement and how important it is, and I totally agree, 100%. But what about the people who aren't thinking that this is an issue? There's a lot of people in Canada who don't think of water as a current issue. We're in a water-rich country. We're fine here. It's not the truth. So my comment is, we need to engage the people who don't see this as a problem. And I don't know what the IJC can do in terms of that, but I just think that that is something that's missing within this conversation.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And I only, the only response to part of what you said, which is, how do we engage? I mean, it's a challenge. We've heard it, you know, I've heard a lot in the last few days about we need all the voices. That's one reason why we're having a meeting downtown, because we recognized at the Civic Center tonight, right now, because we recognize that not everybody's going to come out here. So we tried different ways and different venues to make ourselves accessible and make it easier for people to at least reach us. And thank you for saying that. And I think that's it. I want to thank everybody. I want to give a special thanks to Chris and the governments who've are in the midst of putting on an excellent forum, and the IJC staff who directed us to be here. And thank you so much.